the Jesus that Westernized or Western Christians have, or the image of mm-hmm. him that we hold through the scriptures and through mm-hmm. what's been passed down, what's the difference between the Jesus that you have discovered through your writings and through your study, then what's the difference between that Jesus and the Westernized Jesus?
I'd say it's not so much a difference. You could say it's a difference in quality or a difference in depth, in that the Jesus that is sometimes promoted by Western Christianity, and Western Christianity is very diverse, sometimes tends to be a bit two-dimensional. He becomes in some ways a picture, if for want of a better word, an icon, but not in the Eastern sense of an icon. More something that we stop with rather than go through, which is more the Eastern sense of the way icons are used. We look through the icon seeing us, we see the icon. So for me, it's sort of a more three-dimensional focus on what his teaching actually was rather than what he represents as a symbol or as an icon.
How do we go, what are ways you're teaching to go through Jesus? What are some things that can be done to go through Jesus rather than kind of just keep him separate or as a figure or an icon?
Well, I think there are two things that my work is focusing on. One is actually chanting, praying with Jesus' words in Aramaic. That alone creates this sense of depth. This was the ancient practice he was teaching that he came from. You breathe with, you say the words of the teacher, of the prophet, in their language, and by that you resonate, you come into rhythm with them as a living experience. That's one thing.
With coming into rhythm, how is that done? Through chanting, or is it through prayer?
Through chanting, through the breath, and through sound. These are the ancient Middle Eastern ways of doing it. Not through visualizing, that is making visual pictures, but through actually feeling the rhythm of the breath, the vibration of the voice, the chant in the language. This is what we find is the underlying way of prayer in the Middle Eastern tradition.
And why has that been lost?
I think, again, not because necessarily any bad intent or evil intent. It's just that it was a limitation of Jesus's words strained out through Greek language and then further from the Greek through what I call a Platonic, that is a philosophically oriented to Plato way of looking at these words. So you have ancient Semitic ways of prayer, of story, of spiritual practice that are strained out through a way of looking, a worldview that is entirely unlike them. And that is as different as, you know, between Lao Tzu and Italian, you know, something like that. So it's this, each on their own terms can be wonderful. And even Western Christianity has some beautiful things that it has given birth to. We think of, you know, the beautiful music and art and poetry that was inspired over the centuries also by this. But again, my little part of this is to offer some doorway into Jesus' original way of prayer, his original way of spirituality. For Jesus himself, I still find his main influences are from, you could say, an indigenous Middle Eastern spirituality. I wouldn't limit things to Judaism, because there was no organized Judaism at the time of Jesus, but I would say all of what he's teaching is still from what I would call an indigenous native Middle Eastern, and this is a term I tended to coin, actually, sort of a native Middle Eastern spirituality. But that can extend from ancient Egypt through this whole region and include the traditions that were before, including the multiple versions of the old Hebrew tradition. Now the relations between, say, Jesus' teaching and Buddhism, they can be read both ways, because we can't discount that the evidence for some of these things may have been read backwards. Although we've got the historical Buddha at an era before Jesus, what was found as evidence along the Silk Road of influence of Buddhism on Christianity actually may have been the other way around, from what the research I've read is, that you have, largely unreported outside of Western history, the history of the Silk Road religion is a history of mixing of all sorts of different traditions, Buddhism, Taoism, Aramaic Christianity, some form of non-rabbinical Judaism, and also when Islam comes along, then also some form of perhaps non-Orthodox Islam. So all of this is mixing in this wonderful area that's stretching from the Middle East all the way to China.
With the mysticism of Jesus and also the miracles associated with him, because that was a large part of who he was this, you know, feeding the 5,000, death and resurrection.
Yes.
Healing people, deliverance, that kind of thing. How would he have learned that?
Well, there was a healing tradition. There's an ancient healing tradition in the Middle East that uses some very similar techniques to what Jesus is using. We didn't go into it that much during this weekend, but there's another body of work that I've done around, especially around Jesus's Beatitudes, that point out the relationship between the Beatitudes and traditional Middle Eastern, ancient Middle Eastern healing techniques, including some of the things that he was using. Breathing with a person, saying words like Eth Fatah, this sort of connection to the person from the inside that in a somatic psychological point of view, if you want to get materialistic about it, some of these things are recognized as possible healing ways, using sound, for instance. Using awareness of breathing to heal people.
How does that happen? Meaning, if it's something that Jesus passed on to his disciples, because
yes.
as a disciple,
yes.
you know, in Acts, people
yes.
are healing people, and
yes.
it's explosive. And I personally, I've seen miracles happen.
Sure.
I've seen them happen in all different kinds of ways. But because a lot of in charismatic world,
yes.
there is the teaching of sound and vibration and that
hands-on
kind of thing.
Healing, all of this, exactly.
Yeah. How do you do that? Have you ever seen that? Have you participated?
I have experienced it, yes. I won't say that I've done it, but I won't say I haven't done it. But in a simple way of describing the way it happens is, it's simple and it's difficult. You connect first with the other person in breath. You bring your breath rhythm in tune with theirs. And sometimes in somatic psychology, this is called connecting and training body awareness with another person. In what's called a proprioceptive sense. Now that's Western somatic psychological terminology. Breath to breath with the person, your breath to the greater breath. Mm-hmm. Everybody comes back into rhythm in some deeper way. And the coming back into rhythm is this healing, this making whole, in a very deep sense. So this is the way I believe it would have happened.
Is there a way for a person who heals and moves in miracles, or in this case, Jesus, that he came to a point where he bore fruit, meaning that he was ripe in terms of his ability to create miracles and to be messianic? Do you think that Jesus took a path of even what he taught was ripeness, where he starts out with some level of power and understanding and then moves into a greater power until it's obvious to everyone around him? Do you think could that be one way of...
My feeling is that yes, that likely happened. Now, we don't know that whole process of how that happened, although what we do know is what he's trying to show his students, which would suggest from what he's saying at the end of John that he went through some similar process with this of learning.
Wow.
Trying things out, trial and error, and then, as you would say, becoming more and more a vehicle of ripeness, of blessing.
And can that be passed on to him, to his followers today?
Why not?
Okay, cool.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good.
That's great.